I made a big bet on wireless bridge networking a long time ago, and for a while, it was great. No wires, flexible setup, total wireless freedom. But as more and more people around me got more powerful access points, the 2.4 GHz band turned into a congested mess. Now, even 5 GHz is starting to feel just as crowded. And believe it or not, there's one more expected player in all of this. Radar. Yep, actual radar signals that can interfere with 5 GHz wireless bridges, forcing them to switch channels suddenly, which is the last thing you want when trying to keep a stable connection. So not only am I battling neighbors and devices, but even radar is out to disrupt my network. Today, I'm taking on the challenges of making a wireless bridge work reliably. I'll show you what worked, what didn't, and how I finally ended up with a solid wireless bridge that just works. And just in case you're wondering, a network bridge is basically a way to connect two separate networks so they function as one. In my setup, I want to bridge my house network with my garage network without running a physical cable between them. To do this, I need one access point to act as the main access point, while the other one acts as the client, extending the connection and providing network access to everything downstream. But network bridges don't have to be as complex as my garage setup or even cover large distances. It can be much simpler, like using a small access bridge to connect a switch on your workbench to your main network. It's a straightforward way to add connectivity right where you need it without running extra cables. I'm sure a lot of you are already thinking, why not dig a trench? And believe me, I've considered it. But running a physical cable would mean drilling through my basement wall, tunneling under a 10-foot cement patio, weaving through the yard while avoiding a buried electric line, and then drilling into stucco on the wall. It's a lot of work and quite a mess to deal with. And about 10 years ago, I solved this problem already with a Linksys access point running DDWRT, which worked great until I needed more bandwidth. Then I upgraded the bridge to a UniFi AC Pro, which was also one of my first YouTube videos. Those devices are real workhorses, and their second Ethernet port made them perfect for building a bridge. But as I added more 5 GHz devices, and my neighbors did too, interference became an issue. Eventually, my garage cameras started dropping off the network, and that's when I realized it was time to explore better options for my bridge. So my mission became to build the fastest, most reliable wireless bridge I could. Now, many of the networking items we're using today, you can actually pick up from today's sponsor, Micro Center.
Now, Micro Center is honestly one of my favorite go-to spots when it comes to networking hardware, especially if I need it today.
They carry pretty much everything you need to upgrade or build your network from scratch, including UniFi gear that I'm testing today, plus a ton of other brands and products. And if you're like me and planning a big upgrade, there's nothing like seeing the products in person to help you decide which is best for your setup. For instance, there's this U6 mesh with Wi-Fi 6, which can cover up to 1500 square feet and even connect up to 300 clients. And I never would have known it's actually this small had I not come into the store. Or this U7 Pro access point, which has Wi-Fi 7 and 6 gigahertz support, 2.5 gigabit uplinks, and all of this is available right now at Micro Center. So whether you're looking for an advanced Wi-Fi 6 or 7 access point, a full mesh setup, or even a point-to-point solution, Micro Center has you covered. Their knowledgeable staff is here to answer any questions and help you find the perfect setup, even if networking isn't your thing. And right now, Micro Center's fall savings event is happening with discounts on items like Intel and AMD CPUs. And be on the lookout for Black Friday deals coming this November. You won't want to miss those. So make a trip to your nearest Micro Center and check out these deals. And if you're in the Bay Area, sign up for early access to their upcoming Micro Center location, set to open in early 2025. New and existing customers who sign up will get a free 128 gigabyte flash drive. First, I looked at improving what I already have, which was a mesh network setup bridging the network to my garage. A mesh network generally involves multiple access points working together to cover a large area, with devices automatically connecting to the strongest signal. In my setup, I have the U6 Enterprise access point in my house and the AC Pro in the garage. I started by trying to upgrade the existing mesh. I replaced the AC Pro in the garage with a UniFi device bridge, or the UDB, but it still ended up with a weak signal. Now, this was one of the few devices that Ubiquiti sent me for testing, and I thought, what better way to test it than in the real world? The UDB is a dedicated bridging device, which means it connects my garage to the main network, but doesn't extend the Wi-Fi coverage like my AC Pro does. This created a problem since I need Wi-Fi coverage in the garage and not just a wireless connection back. Next, I tried replacing it with the UDB Pro. This device is directional, which means I have to aim it directly at my Wi-Fi source in the house. It worked out pretty good, but the signal was still borderline acceptable going through the stucco of the garage, and I'd have to find a better way to mount it, either awkwardly mounting it inside the garage or drilling holes to install it outside. After trying to improve my existing mesh network, I realized I needed a completely different approach. I briefly considered setting up a dedicated point-to-point bridge. Now, this kind of setup involves two directional antennas to create a focused link between two locations, like my house and the garage. It's capable of delivering a strong, stable connection, even over long distances of up to 3 miles or more. However, for my needs, I felt like this was over-engineering. Point-to-point bridges are great for situations where you need high reliability over long distances, but in my case, the distance between my house and the garage doesn't really justify the complexity. Plus, I would have to mount both antennas outdoors for line of sight, which isn't ideal, and I would still need a separate solution to extend the Wi-Fi coverage in the garage itself. So I was close to giving up, honestly. After all, I didn't want to go through all of this trouble just for some moderate improvements. Then I took a step back and thought about my network setup. Why was I trying to connect an access point inside of my house, through walls, through stucco, across the yard, and then more stucco to the access point in the garage? It just didn't make sense. That's when I started looking into the idea of mounting an access point outside. I started exploring my options for outdoor access points, considering different models that could work for this setup. I knew I wanted something directional since I was planning to mount it on the house and face it directly towards the garage. An omnidirectional AP wouldn't be ideal as it would end up competing with my indoor access points. Plus, I wanted Wi-Fi 7 to future-proof my setup. After weighing all these factors, I ultimately decided to go with Ubiquiti's recommendation, the UniFi U7 Outdoor, which they sent me for this project. It checked all the boxes: directional, high performance, outdoor, and ready for Wi-Fi 7. Now, the U7 Outdoor is honestly overkill for my small city lot, but its performance and range is incredible. During my test, I could connect to it from over a block away, even without line of sight, which is pretty impressive. And when I tried Wi-Fi 7 with a 240 MHz channel width, it's pretty wide, I was seeing speeds close to a gigabit per second on my Pixel 8. These results were incredible on their own. I feel like I could do an entire video on this access point, but they really didn't apply to my setup. The real goal here was still to try to create a reliable bridge to the garage. So I ran a Cat6 cable, terminated it, and gave the access point a little face and mounted it to my house. I added it to my existing network and kept all of the default settings for a good starting point. Once everything was set up, I tested the UniFi device bridge's connection to see if I needed to make any adjustments. So did my wireless bridge pay off? Well, let's take a look at the results. Once I had the device bridge connected to the UniFi U7 Outdoor, I ran a speed test using iPerf 3. I set up iPerf 3 on my main machine in the house and another machine in the garage to test the network performance. Without any tuning and using a 40 MHz channel width, I was able to get around 150 megabits per second. Now, this was definitely an improvement over my previous setup, but far from what I was hoping for. Next, I widened the channel width all the way up to 240 MHz and checked to see if there were any available channels, including DFS channels, which I hadn't worked with before. Now, DFS channels are part of the 5 GHz band, and they share the spectrum with military radar, weather radar, and satellite systems. And if they're not in use, they can be repurposed for Wi-Fi. There are pros to using these DFS channels. Since fewer people are using these channels, they often provide less congestion and a faster connection. But the downside is that access points must periodically scan for radar, and if radar is detected, the access point must switch to another channel, which can cause disruptions. Now, I didn't expect this to happen in my area, but within 24 hours of enabling DFS channels, radar was detected twice, forcing the U7 to switch channels. Now, it was awesome to see in action, but it also made me realize that relying on DFS channels here might not be the best idea, given that it can interrupt my network at any time. After these initial changes, I also cranked the transmit power up to high. Now, this can sometimes increase interference for you and your neighbors, but since the DFS channels at the time seemed clear, I decided to go for it. With the channel width increased and transmit power turned up, my speeds improved to around 300 megabits per second. Still, I felt like there was room for improvement. Then I adjusted iPerf 3 to run 4 parallel threads, which increased my throughput to around 400 megabits per second. And Even then, I thought I could push things a little bit further. I decided to check the CPU on the small N200 machine I was using in the garage, and as I suspected, the CPU was maxing out, likely bottlenecking the network performance. To solve this, I swapped it out for a Minisforum MSA1, and with the MSA1 in place, I finally hit 500 megabits per second. So now, not only was my bridge connection faster, but the signal quality was also significantly better, meaning fewer dropped packets, fewer retries, and most importantly, no interruptions to my garage camera feeds. Now, I feel like 10x performance gains over what I had before is pretty significant. But more importantly, I finally have a stable connection to my garage. Sometimes a simple idea can lead you down a rabbit hole of fine-tuning, problem-solving, late-night cable running. But that's half the fun, right? And in the end, with just two new pieces of hardware, I was able to transform my old, unreliable wireless bridge into something I can finally rely on. And for now, I think this setup is great. Plus, there's that added bonus, seeing my wireless network halfway around the world. If you'd like to see more of the process, installing the hardware, crimping Cat 6, and a few hiccups along the way, and more in-depth testing, check out my other channel that I'll have linked below. I'm Tim. Thanks for watching.